George Golovko. He has received his BS a few years back in computer science from Odessa National Polytechnic University. Then from there, he got his degree, his PhD in computer science, just down the street at University of Houston. We were able to entice him to come even further down the street to University of Texas Medical Branch, where he's professor down there, and he directs kind of a center for microbiome sequencing and analysis, and he's really the lead scientist at our Center for Emerging Infectious Disease. But even better than that, he's kind of, you know, the brains down there for anyone doing, you know, big data on the campus and using the data sets that are available. And he has some great initiatives with the medical students and any researchers that want to get involved in big data. So I turn it over to George.
Thank you for being here at 4 p.m. And I'm going to beat this dead horse about the data even further down. I hope I will give some very concrete examples when we're working with real-world evidence data. And I would like to add just a little bit about myself, because I literally wake up with the data and go to sleep with the data. Being part of the West African Center for Emerging Infectious Disease, I have meetings at 4 a.m. in the morning when I wake up with Senegal, and we oversee their data, how they collect and kill mosquitoes, collecting viruses, moving it through the lab, and how it gets transferred back here, and then end up in the vaccine development, as well as overseeing the same partnership with Hawaii. So that's with whom I go to sleep, with the data. And therefore, I have a very extensive expertise looking through the evolution stage of the data, how it is developed, and obviously I have to deal with all the issues regarding the data. However, today I want to specifically talk about the real world evidence data, and even more specifically clinical data, because this is where my biggest expertise. As you heard already, for a while, what type of data we consider real-world evidence data, it's electronic health record, sponsor registers. This is where we get all our cancer data. Actually, we get very little from EMR itself. Most of it comes from the registries, administrative claims, pre- and post-market and pharmacy data, as well as feedback from wearable technologies. So how this all started, or how this all developed to where we are right now, and why do we have? These two very important historical acts that were voted for in 2009 and 2016, they created this huge push to have and organize data. Did we have the data before? Yes, we did. It was stored in absolutely ugly format, in some custom database Excel files and whatever you can imagine it has been stored with. And after ACT in 2016, this is where we start getting more or less good data. And I'm talking about it from practical perspective, because all the 100 studies that we already conducted using clinical data, 99% of the high quality data will be from 2016. There are some very advanced universities such as Vanderbilt who managed to go back and uncover and clean and prepare and do a fantastic job on organizing and preparing the data for quite quality for research. But that's not the case for majority universities or medical school, including UTMB. And obviously, as a result of this data organization and some kind of rule enforcement in this field, we got this wonderful data sharing initiatives such as CTSA and ACT Shrine, I2B2, N3C, Trinetics, all of us, Picornet, and many, many others that I will not have time to cover even if I want to. So when we're talking about real-world evidence data and how patient data becomes real-world evidence data, I want to take on a little journey in case of UTMB. So you will see how it progresses over time and how it accumulates size at every stage. So UTMB started using heavily Epic in around 2015. It was initially installed before and was used to collecting data, but the quality of the data and all the necessary tools were nowhere there. So it was just a big data storage, pretty useless for anything else other than following up the course of treatment for the patients. In 2018, we start exporting data from the identifiable format to de-identifiable format to sort of liberalize or democratize the data. So everybody can access it without IRB requirement, have it on the spot, updated frequently, and therefore make it available to many more researchers to make it this data is actionable and that somebody can actually extract the knowledge from this data. Further down in 2019, as a part of the CTSA, we were linked to the ACT Shrine Network, where we get access to 50 healthcare organizations similar to ours. And obviously, our patient population grew from 2.1 million up to 150 million patient records, which was already impressive achievement, but we did not stop. And in 2020, during the pandemic era, since we were sitting at home and have a lot of time to do nerdy stuff remotely, we start participating in the Trinetics network, where we moved from the local data analysis to worldwide data analysis and get access to 200 healthcare organizations worldwide and 500 million patients, which on a paper sounds fantastic since we have a lot of data. So things like power analysis and then number was not the case that we have to be worried about anymore. You name the disease and we have at least 100,000 cases available to us with the two mouse clicks to work with such data. Moreover, we did not stop yet. In 2020, we participated in this N3C archive that was focusing on the data, specifically focusing on COVID treatment, and we participated through Trinetics. They did a big heavy lifting of the data management for us to be able to participate and generate this data. And right now, we are engaging in two very promising projects. One is Evidex. This is Trinetics and that very clinical trial safety outcome database that will be linked to the clinical database that we have currently in Trinetics. Therefore, we will be able to check the signals reported to FDA and confirm it with the identified clinical data that we supply and other healthcare organizations supply. And moreover, going for the next round of the CTSA, currently we're merging our de-identified clinical data with the Methodist. So as a result, we expect that in fourth quarter, we will have a fully aggregated, harmonized quality control population data from UTMB and Methodist available to both groups from both university, and hopefully we will further down explore this network. In this case, Trinetics will serve as the lowest denominator for both of us in terms of quality and type of data that will be available. How do we actually use this data? So it's one thing that we organize data, we collect the data, we clean the data. How this data is actually used by our groups inside of UTMB and outside of UTMB. 99% of the application is comparing the effectiveness of treatments and interventions in clinical decision-making and healthcare policy. In simple terms, it's design an experimental control cohort, balance them properly, and check for a specific outcome or the efficacy of particular treatment to treat patients. Health economics and outcome research. Good example would be our studies with emergency medicine when the new drug came to the market and they wanted to see if some other healthcare organization already adopted it, what was the effect, and would it help for specific type of patients that they oversee in EM. Personalized medicine is self-explanatory. Clinical trials optimization and recruitment. It's very interesting way how it was applied at UTMB. There was a very brief pilot study that ended up being a conference abstract on Stevens-Johnson syndrome, which we total have around 12,000 cases around the nations. 5,000 of those were had actually useful data for the analysis. And it spin off a clinical trial on Stevens-Johnson syndrome at UTMB with other partners who have patients experiencing this disease. And safety surveillance and post-market studies, I think we at this moment just entering this particular application, but do not have much experience at this moment. So having 500 million patients is a fantastic problem to have, but this comes at a cost. And there are many things wrong with the data, and you heard most of it, but I would like to focus on three. The most important, I think, is data quality, building the data literacy, because just making data available does not make this data useful. If nobody can use your data, this is just a bunch of bits and pieces, and it's pretty useless. And another one that being debated and criticized is data democratization. Who owns the data? Who owns the research? And how do we get access to this data? So in terms of data quality, you heard a lot, and I don't want to go too deep into it, but I'll just bring a couple of real examples. What do we mean? Because as I show you, the past data travels from UTMB to the National Archives. All the errors and all the missingness and all the issues with the data propagate on much bigger scale. So first one is quite obvious one, missingness. on average, from the project that we ran, 25% of patients have only single entry of BMI throughout their entire life, which seems to be ridiculous. Every time you go to the doctors, they put you on the weight and tell me how obese I am. So this probably should be one of the most common or one of the frequent observations. And that data is not available neither as a BMI nor as the calculatable value that you can. And a lot of clinical research questions consider BMI as a either balancing factor, covariate, or actually one of the most important factors for specific outcome. And it's not just an error. It's also how we're collecting the data and how the data migrates from one healthcare organization to another healthcare organization. I'll give you one example. A year ago, when I have to evacuate my grandma from Ukraine and I brought her here, she's 84 years old. She went to the doctor and all her medical records is she is non-COVID positive and she has a doctor visit. If you're blindly conducting clinical study using her patient record, she is ideal candidate for control cohort for anything. You have 84-year-old that never took the drug and never developed the comorbidity. Like, you cannot have a better patient. But this is wrong. We know that wrong, and if we will evaluate, we will know. So this missingness has a lot of different angles how to look, and it's not always an error. Inconsistent data, diagnosis versus procedures. We always have this question, like, what do you trust more? Diagnosis set by doctor or CPT procedure that was actually built for? Because CPT procedure has better oversight, instinctively, you would trust a CPT that hospital was built and was audited for, you would trust it more. But that's just not the case. You all went probably to the dentist when you went going for a cleaning, and you get 20 CPT codes added on top of it. So truth is somewhere in between, and there are many different other aspects of inconsistent data that is propagating. Conflicting data, pregnant males, as well as NOP versus EMR. If we right now go to any publicly available RWE system and try to find males who was pregnant, you will find at least a couple of dozen of cases. Again, it has two issues. One of them is the way how we record the data. While diagnosis and procedures, they have longitudinal structure, and you can see when it happened. Sex do not. So we actually follow for one specific case why this is happening, and we found a female patient who had a C-section and then had a sex change. Therefore, the data is correct, but how you interpret it is completely up to you and up to the type of the project that you're trying to do. With NLP versus EMR, this is even more interesting. Yes, NLP uncover a lot of data that is not input directly by nurse or a healthcare practitioner, but it can come, for example, from pathology reports. And then you have conflicting data, not related to pathology report, but one of the recent example I remember about COVID. When patient telephoned and said, I had COVID, and the result come back and says, patient do not have COVID. Both go into the clinical records. None of them override the other one. So how do you decide, was it a COVID patient or not? Not directly. You definitely can follow up a couple of days and see if there are other symptoms that would highlight whether it was COVID or not. And variability in data collection. Just to continue on the COVID example, in 2020, when all this pandemic started, and we're trying to defy a COVID phenotype. Every single medical school, healthcare organization decided to make their own mRNA test to detect COVID. So in order for you to confirm that the patient has COVID, they need to have UO7 code and one of the 85 different mRNA test positives. This is insane. And at least the answer there is yes or no. But there are many medical devices that have variability of values and within different ranges and with different sensitivity. So this is another issue that arises specifically for data quality. And now another one, challenges to the democratization of health data. So we all know that in order to get access to the clinical data, you have to need to write to IRB, follow HIPAA compliancy, and perform a lot of steps to get access to this data, which in the modern world seems a little bit ridiculous. It would take me a day to buy every one of your cellular data and figure out your PHI, what you were searching, what you were looking for, and it will be quite cheap too. to do the same thing with your data, just to figure out did you go to doctor yesterday or not, it will take me 3-4 months of IRB in every individual clinical institution that you go into. This is just not sustainable, and this needs to change somehow. Another problem is who owns your data. You saw how data travel for UTMB. I'm UTMB patient. So at first, my data belongs to UTMB. Then my data belongs to Xtrine. Then my data belongs to Trinetics. Then my data belongs to N3C. The only thing is certain, it does not belong to me, because I don't make any decision on this path. Whoever is releasing this data, and what's happening right now, some of the journals put this to another extreme. And I'll give you one practical example. We're right now going through the fight with PLOS ONE, where the paper was reviewed, accepted, no comments, and editorial come back, please release your data to us. And this become a significant legal challenge, because data belongs to Trinetics. Online tool was used to generate the result and to come to conclusion. Nobody have ever touched their own data. We cannot release it because it does not belong to us. Moreover, research was conducted by medical students. They do not have an expertise to export 200,000 patients, repackage them properly, and give it to PLOS ONE. And Trinetics also have their side. They say that we just simply cannot allow to do this to you, because worst case scenario, you will publish a single paper on each therapeutic area, and you will be the point of contact, and you will be the source of the data instead of Trinetics. So these questions are keep popping up over and over again, and we need somehow to deal with it. And I heard a lot of comments like, what can we do about the data? As the person who collects the data, harmonize the data, and release the data, I can tell you very little we can actually do about the data. It will go through its own evolution. We will collect it more. We will know how to do better. But what we can do already, we can teach how to work with the bad, dirty data, what to be on lookout for, and what to be prepared for, where you're going for submission, for example, and going through. So while we were building infrastructure at UTMB, we conducted about 20 annual workshops on how to work, analyze, collect, and submit this kind of data. We aggregated all the comments that we were able to get and feedback from the senior leadership at UTMB, and we organized an interdisciplinary class for medical students, residents, and fellows, as well as graduate students, working together, trying to use specifically only real-world evidence data, unclean, unsupervised, to generate their particular hypothesis, how to test hypothesis, and how to guide them to make as precise outcome as possible. And as you can see, this is the list of the final project that these students were able to generate, which says that technically, you can take any smart person without any technical background or medical background, and within a semester, bring them to the speed to be able to use this data effectively and generate high quality research that will be publishable and usable further. In a nutshell, this is what we're trying to explain them, that as a first step, you need to understand what data you have at your disposal and how to deal with this data. At a step one, you will probably need a slightly different set of tools that you were exposed during your epidemiology and biostats classes, because now you're working with hundreds of thousands and millions of patients. Your experimental cohort can be 1,000 patients. Your control cohort can be 10 million patients. How do you compare them? How do you properly select them? How do you balance them? So there are a set of tools and exercises that we push students through to be able to work with this big data and big data analysis. And finally, how to interpret results of the analysis and verify your studies in silico before you go for the experiment or starting ordering animals and reagents. We presented our class several times at the Trinetics Summit and a couple of the conference, and we got a collaboration with Stony Brook, who pretty much adopted the same idea. They completely agreed that all the gaps that we identified in data and working with data completely applicable to them, and they pretty much adopt whole class for their fellowship. They have biomedical informatics fellowship, and this class will be taught for them. Moreover, we decided to gamify it a little bit, And in October, we will have sort of like a hackathon. It's not really a hackathon in the sense how we used to it, when there is a final app to be developed. But it mostly, we will raise some questions. For example, are antibiotics good or bad for a particular clinical scenario? One team will need to present that they're good. The other will compete against them, saying that antibiotics are bad and causing other damages. And so far, it's going to be Stony Brook and UTB Health. But we're completely open if anybody else wants to participate in this kind of exercise. And we'll be more than happy to connect with everybody who will be participating in it. So I want to thank all these people who help. We have a very little focus group. Without them, especially senior clinical personnel, nothing of this would happen. One of the conclusions become obvious. You can teach medical students or epidemiological students how to use big data analytical tools, but it's very difficult to teach data scientists medicine. Thank you.